Good morning, everyone. My name is Brandon. I'm one of the pastors here at Legacy. It's a joy to be worshiping with you on this, the fourth Sunday of Advent and Christmas Sweater Sunday. If I forget, there is a photo area by the fireplace. Be sure to snag a picture before you go today. I get to join in the fun. Make it snow. If you are joining us online, be sure to have some communion elements ready. We're going to celebrate communion just after the message today. So we've been spending this Advent season looking at the titles Jesus was called in the Christmas stories. So we've seen Christ the King, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus our Emmanuel. These are all found in Matthew and Luke's ancient biographies on Jesus' life. And in those stories, you get the Christmas story that so many people know and love, with all the angels and shepherds, mangers, animals, wise men, you name it. But imagine a Christmas story without all of those characters. None of them. That's what we get in John's biography of Jesus' life. This is John's Christmas story. The Word became flesh. That's it. Four words is all we get. The Word became flesh. No angels, no shepherds, no dreams, no manger. Just the Word became flesh. What does that even mean? Who or what is the Word? What is John trying to get at us with this four-letter Christmas story? We're going to be in John 1 today. You can follow along in your own Bible, on your favorite device, or on the screen with me. This is John 1:1. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created. His life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Jesus is the Word. John chooses that description, that title for Jesus, in these first few verses. This means Jesus has always been. Jesus was there for the creation of the universe, the setting of the galaxies in place, the placement of our sun in our solar system. Jesus gave life to everything that was created. John's opening to his biography is huge. Jesus is God. The Christian notion of the Trinity, of one God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, finds its roots in passages like this. Now jump down to verse 9 in John. We read, "The one who is true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. So the Word became human and made his home among us." That's John's Christmas story again. The Word, that is Jesus, became human and made his home among us. It's short, but it is the most deep and complex of all the Christmas stories. John just told you Jesus is God in the flesh, the Creator, the Eternal One. And now, as you read the book of John, you're going to see how exactly all of that plays out. You know, if you get nothing else this Advent season, I hope you recapture the wonder that is the incarnation of God becoming one of us. You might have heard this story so many times that it doesn't sound crazy anymore, that the God of the universe, all-powerful, all-knowing, becomes a lowly human being like us. That is strange. That is ridiculous. And it sounds crazy to many people on the planet. And yet there is something mysterious and captivating in this story every single year. Every now and then, it even bubbles up and breaks through into pop culture. I'm going to take you back to a music video from the 90s. Watch this.
If you were faced with him and all
Well, that was a 90s music video. Apparently, we learned we loved super close-ups. Holy cow, are we zoomed in on Joan Osborne's face. We also liked sepia orange filters. And apparently, nose rings were much long before they are today. Gen Xers had nose rings long before millennials and Gen Z made them cool. Now, when I first heard this song, it was probably about 95 or 96, my sister and brother were watching MTV and were all in the same room. And this has happened maybe twice I can remember. By the way, MTV is how we found music before YouTube and streaming services. So in and of itself, my brother and sister in the same room, this is a unique event. So this song plays all the way through, and my brother and my sister start talking about what questions you might ask. What would you ask God if God was indeed just sitting in the bus with you as you're riding on the way home? That is a wonderful conversation to engage in. But instead of engaging their conversation, entering it, my 14, 15-year-old self just kills the conversation by saying, come on, it's already been done before. Remember Jesus, that guy, been there, done that. Let's move on. Hell, thank you, conversation killer. So don't do what I did. Like I said, the incarnation eventually pops up and bubbles up into pop culture every now and then. So engage in the mysterious and the wonderful conversations that can develop. We celebrate this every single year, and we may not understand how billions of people think this idea is just crazy. Some folks would simply say God, who created everything, would never become a dirty, improper, ungodlike to become a human being. And we respectfully disagree. We hold on to this radical belief that God did indeed become flesh in Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus lived during the Roman oppression in Israel in the early decades of the first century. Our scripture this morning from John 1 is actually a song. It is a poem. It is one of the first hymns that was written by Christians to explain and to teach this crazy idea that God did indeed put on flesh and became one of us. Now, this song in John 1 leaves no doubt that Jesus is fully divine, 100% God, and 100% human. Jesus has been around like God since the beginning. You know, if you're in church for a while, you can become comfortable with this notion that Jesus is God. Okay, I can conceptualize that, but Jesus is also very human. When Jesus says stuff like, you will do greater things than I have done, that makes zero sense if he's saying them as God. We cannot create an entire universe and put galaxies in place. But if he's saying that in the context of being a limited, time-bound human being, things begin to clear up. Now let's inject a little humanity into Jesus' birth, his arrival. Was the first Christmas really a silent night? Some of you all have had infants and newborns before. It's always rainbows and unicorns the first 24 hours, right? Now, I'm sure there were sweet and quiet moments, but was the entire night a beautiful, silent night? Did the creator of the universe come quietly and beautifully like we always see? I mean, I don't think so. Imagine traveling with a woman who is 9 months pregnant on a donkey, no heated seats, for miles to discover that there is no room at the hotel, so you're going to have to stay in the barn. Joseph, I told you to call ahead to reserve a room, but did you listen? No, of course you didn't. You were too busy playing with your new tools for Christmas, and now we don't have a bed. Well, Mary, you could have called just as well. You've got fingers, don't you? Not to mention labor and contractions and the birth of Jesus. Did I mention Jesus pooped with no disposable diapers? Now, Jesus is 100% human and God. My guess is that first Christmas light did not sound like an episode of Leave It to Beaver, like Silent Night might make it out to be. Now, the Chosen TV series, they currently just completed 2 seasons, does a phenomenal job of injecting humanity into Jesus and the disciples, his first followers. They fill in the story and the experiences around the characters that our biographies on Jesus' life didn't have the room, and it wasn't their purpose to do that. So to give you a taste of the humanity of Jesus, here's a scene of Jesus talking with Peter's wife, Eve. Watch this.
But I see you. You understand? I know It is not easy to be at home when your husband is out doing all of this. Even when you are excited about it and proud of him. So, I wouldn't ask you to do this without taking care of a few things.
You mean?
Plus, normal Simon is difficult enough. You think I want to travel with a worried Simon?
No.
No, I do not.
A fever spiked. Her forehead burns my hand to the touch.
We should get a doctor.
There is no need.
Who are you?
This is Jesus of Nazareth.
You've never met him before.
Welcome to my son-in-law's home.
Thank you.
What am I doing lying here?
You had a terrible fever.
And all of you staring down.
Dasha, don't.
No one move. I'll be right back with some drinks.
And here, dear, come for this fire.
Coming.
Let's see. Ryan butter for Simon, pomegranate arrows.
Thank you.
Goat cheese.
Thank you.
Does your friend like goat cheese?
Yes, I love goat cheese.
I should, yeah, see about the goat cheese.
Just wonderful and absolutely human. If you haven't seen this yet, you can find The Chosen on their own app, YouTube, and the Peacock streaming service. It follows in John's vein of Jesus being, yes, fully God, but also fully human with a wonderful sense of humor. You know, the song in 1 John, it continues by describing Jesus as bringing light and life into a world filled with darkness and death. You get this picture painted of Jesus bringing life to all who accept who Jesus is, but notes that his own people, Jesus' people, the Israelites, many do not accept him. And this song is a prologue. It's an introduction. It's a teaser. It's supposed to whet your appetite for all the 21 chapters that are to come. You're supposed to ask, well, why didn't Jesus' people accept him? How does Jesus bring light to darkness, to places that are dark and full of death? You know, it seems that the purpose for John writing this gospel was to help people, to teach people about wisdom. Now stay with me for a minute. Wisdom in the first century was defined like this. Wisdom is the skill of living well. It's making the right decisions. It prolongs and promotes life, health, and happiness, even in a dark world. I mean, who wouldn't want wisdom like that? I want to make right decisions. I would like to live a nice, long, and healthy, and happy life in this world. And you gain wisdom by studying parables and stories, riddles and other forms of metaphorical speech offered by Jewish sages and teachers. Wisdom became associated with things like eternal life, resurrection, and salvation. Heard any of those words before? John's purpose right here and in the whole gospel is to basically say this. You want wisdom? You want to live life to the full? Then wisdom is standing right there in the flesh in Jesus Christ. You want to live well? You want to make right decisions that give you a long, healthy life? Then follow the way of this carpenter from Nazareth. You want eternal life, salvation, and resurrection? Then follow Jesus. In fact, many of the sayings Jesus uses in the book of John, he co-opts and reinterprets them. Here's a couple of the pop culture phrases in Jesus' day. Wisdom is the light of the world. Wisdom is the way, the truth, and the life. Wisdom is the true vine. And then from the book of John, I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. We celebrate Christmas because wisdom put on flesh came into the dark world to bring light and life to everyone who wants it. Friends, you want to live well? You want life to the full? It's time to follow Jesus. This song in John 1, it teaches us Jesus is 100% God and 100% human. It teaches us that wisdom, eternal life, resurrection, salvation are found in Jesus. And one of my favorite parts of the song is this section. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we've seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. So if you want to live well, if you want to be your true self, then follow Jesus by believing he said who he said he was and do his best to do what he told us to do. As we strive, as we yearn, as we seek to do what Jesus has us to do, he changes us. He transforms us to be our child of God's selves. We've all been given gifts to use to bring light into the dark places in the world, places that might even be described as dead. How do we do that? How do we bring light to the dark places? And frankly, the answer goes all the way back to the beginning. God sent Jesus in the flesh, moved into our neighborhood to deal with our sin and darkness and death. We do the same. We go and literally move to places where there is darkness, where people need hope and light and life. In our own lives, in our own neighborhoods, are we building people up close to us? Are we bringing light and life in all our interactions? Or are we instead cutting each other down, insulting each other, and bringing darkness and death? How we treat one another is absolutely a reflection of either light or darkness. May love and patience and kindness become our defaults instead of apathy and impatience and rudeness. You know, we also bring light by staying close to the light, by staying close to Jesus, the Word, every day. I think one of the reasons John chose the Word as the title is the importance of the Jewish faith as well as we in the Christian faith have on Scripture. Both Jews and Christians are people of the book, the Torah for Jews and the Old and the New Testament for us Christians. We believe we encounter God in the Scripture. We encounter Jesus as we spend time daily letting those words shape us more than anything else that we might experience. Just like the song says about Jesus, he was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, or grace and truth in other translations. We likewise, we want to be a people of deep love and faithfulness, a people of grace and truth, a people that don't abuse grace, that simply don't do what God tells us to do because we expect God to forgive us. No, we keep striving to live as Jesus lived, to show love and faithfulness, grace and truth to all that we encounter. And we learn this balance, we learn this dance over a lifetime as we stay close to Jesus each and every day. Friends, we read the Bible, we read the written word so that we can get close to Jesus, the living word, to bring light into a world that finds itself in darkness so much of the time. Make a commitment today. Say yes to the Word. Say yes to Jesus and encounter him daily through the written Word. You can go to our website /Bible. There's great ideas for starting a Bible reading if you never have, or to take it deeper if you've been doing this for years upon years upon years. May we all go committed to the written Word so that we can ultimately get close to Jesus, the living Word, and we can bring light and life in his name wherever we go. Let's pray together. Jesus, the living word, we thank you for coming to us, becoming one of us to show us what it looks like to live a life loving God fully and loving neighbor as ourselves. As we go into this holiday week, may you fill us with your love, your patience, and your kindness. As we may have encounters with family and friends that make us uncomfortable or uncertain how it might go, in all areas of our lives, may we stay close to you, where true wisdom, where true life is found. In this moment of silent prayer, we confess to you all the ways we've fallen short in this last week of loving you fully and loving our neighbor as ourselves. We lift to you now in the silence our mistakes, our shortcomings, the sins from the week that was. God, we thank you for forgiving us no matter how many times we might ask. May we never abuse your grace, but go forward into the week through the power of your Spirit, bringing your love and your patience, your grace and forgiveness wherever we may go. We lift up all of the prayers spoken and unspoken today, and we pray together in the way Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying together, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."